I'm on mute. Why not kick it off that way? Hello, everyone. I'm glad that you can see me and now hear me. Thank you so much for having patience with us. Zoom was fighting with us, and we have a great crew here that was fighting right back real hard. We are going to make it through this event. What we have is some fantastic information to share with you all. We're just going to have to pass the baton from host to host. So our transitions may take a little bit longer, but just think of that as a moment for you to reflect and grab a drink if you like. So with that, we're gonna kick this off. If you don't know where you are at Cannabis Equity Now, How Oregon Can Repair the Harms of Cannabis Prohibition. And again, we are so thankful for all of us, you that are here with us today for this important town hall event about why we need to pass the Equity Investment Act, formerly known as the Oregon Cannabis Equity Act, if you have been following along. And today we're gonna more importantly talk about how you can get involved. We have a team that will be dropping action items for you in the chat. So look for lots of great links there. We hope that you all brought open hearts and minds and a question or two about the bill. My name is Kim London. I'm the executive director of the Oregon Cannabis Association. We are a trade organization representing cannabis businesses of all sizes from around Oregon. And my association is just one of many organizations and individuals, over 80 in fact, of the member coalition who crafted and put forward this legislation. Oregon has an incredible opportunity at this moment to set the standard for cannabis equity legislation and what it should look like in the US. Thanks to this incredible wide community effort, meetings with stakeholders, incredible volunteer research and activism, amazing sponsor support from our business community, like you saw in those previous slides, and hundreds of Zoom calls, we have crafted a bill that is going to make meaningful and lasting change to repair the harms of cannabis prohibition. At tonight's event, we're going to hear from folks who had a hand in crafting the bill's legislation, as well as those who are going to benefit from it. We'll let you know where it's at in the legislative process. And more importantly, we'll let you know how you can help us get it across the finish line. We are honored to be joined tonight by some of the bill's legislative supporters, some of whom will be logging in right from the House floor where they are voting at the moment. We're going to be joined by chief sponsors Rep. Julie Fahey and Rep. Karen Power, and bill sponsor Casey Gemma. This is an interactive event, so we are going to need your participation to drive this legislation forward. We're going to have a Q&A section towards the end, so don't feel like you need to just sit back and listen. If you have questions, put them in the chat, and our chat moderator slash MC, Dashita Dawson, will be looking at those, and she'll be asking them of our panel. Now, I am honored to bring up Dr. Rachel Knox, the immediate past chair of the Oregon Cannabis Commission, member of Portland's Cannabis Policy Oversight Team, and co-founder and president of CHEM, the Cannabis Health Equity Movement. Please, everyone, from wherever you are, from your home, your couch, your car, wherever it is you're logging in from, give it up for Dr. Knox, and just give me a brief moment while I promote her to host. And I hope I promoted the right person.
Yes, you did, Kim.
Oh, hey, there you are.
I'm here. Thank you. Thank you, Kim. And I'd really like to give special thanks to you and the rest of this fiercely committed group of organizers that are behind this campaign, who are the heart and the life force of this campaign, for the tremendous amount of time and capacity that made House Bill 3112, right, our Equity Investment Act, possible. And you'll all get to hear from our lead organizers, Representative Akasha Lawrence Spence and Jeanette Ward Horton, in just a moment, because first we have some important business to take care of. We've had amazing sponsors around the state and country rally alongside us in their financial support. So thank you, Groundworks and Weed Maps and Wild and Dutchie, for your generous contributions. But while our sponsors have made an impact, we still have a long road ahead of us, folks, and we ask everyone here today for your support as well. If you not only believe in, but understand that equity should be immutably ubiquitous, right, everywhere, then you understand that social equity, which is the assurance of fairness in policy and regulation, starts right here and with you and with all of us. So in supporting efforts to ensure that cannabis policy in Oregon is equitable, you get to become the social equity vehicle driving us towards progress. Now, a couple of things you can do right now to cast your support or to sign our petition and to donate directly to our campaign through the Cannabis Equity PAC. You'll find links to both the petition and to donate in the chat. And for a little incentivization, all those donating $250 or more throughout the event will be entered into a raffle for a special sponsor prize pack with goodies that include 30 national compliant Cannalite hemp tinctures sponsored by Ohm Extracts, as well as gummies and canna gear from Mendy. And for any donation amount, right, all donations amounts are accepted, you too will be entered into a raffle to receive a special prize. All right, just another note of housekeeping. All donations must be in by 7:10 p.m. That's Pacific time, to be considered for this raffle. And now it's with distinct pleasure on my part that I introduce former State Representative Akasha Lawrence Spence. Our soon-to-be Senator Lawrence Spence works as an incubator for economic growth and the creation of economic sovereignty in frontline communities through civic engagement and her development firm, Fifth Element. Her office answered the call to champion a cannabis equity bill in the legislature and facilitated this massive work group that Kim explained to draft this groundbreaking legislation that we're here this evening to discuss. So without further ado, I will pass that mic to you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Knox. I'm having difficulty starting my video. I don't know if anybody can help me with that. But I'm just going to introduce Jeanette, because she and I do this in tandem. So I want her on screen while we're talking. So I'm going to introduce Jeanette Ward-Horton. She is the CEO of New Leaf Project, a nonprofit that funds and supports cannabis businesses owned by BIPOC founders, as well as people arrested for cannabis criminalization. She also founded the Cannabis Equity Pact, the lobbying force behind HB 3112. And Jeanette, I'm not sure, are we starting the presentation now? Are we doing the slides now?
We are.
Okay.
So I will share those now. And then if Dr. Noss could be so kind as to make you host, then you can share your video.
Okay.
Okay, wonderful.
Okay, still no video for me, but so as Kim mentioned, over the past, I think it's 10 months now, my office facilitated a work group of over 80 plus cannabis industry members, you know, cultivators, retailers, manufacturers from all across our state, as well as partners across the country. We also had community members who had been previously incarcerated and have experienced the impacts of cannabis criminalization and the war on drugs on their lives specifically. What we realized and what we interrogated in this work group was the fact that Oregon has seen over $1 billion in sales in the past 2 years, and yet are the communities most impacted by the war on drugs and cannabis criminalization have yet to see those revenues impact their lives, make a difference in their lives, right the historical wrongs that these policies and this public-private partnership against cannabis and has what created cannabis criminalization, to see that those revenues still have not impacted us in a positive light. What we were able to see is that despite comparable usage, that Black people have been arrested 3.5 times more than white people. We also know that in the state of Oregon, that white Oregonians are incarcerated at a rate that is at a baseline, but Black Oregonians are incarcerated at 480% times higher than the statewide average, compared to 42.5% of our Latinx who are incarcerated at a rate higher than the statewide average, and 9.4% of our Indigenous community members who are incarcerated higher than the statewide average. What we also know is that nationally, one in 87 working age white men is in prison or jail, compared to one in 36 Latinx and one in 12 Black men. And so what we can extrapolate looking at that data is understanding that the income of these families after a parent has been incarcerated is 22% lower than if they had never been incarcerated, which equates to upwards of $179,000 less across their lifetime. The data also tells us that children with fathers who have been incarcerated are expelled or suspended from school at a rate 23% higher than their peers. And so if both education and parental income are strong indicators of a child's future economic mobility, then what we have done is dispossess communities of their wealth and their ability to economically mobilize. And so what we thought about when we crafted this bill is looking at the ways in which we can repair that harm, not only, you know, through what Jeanette is going to talk about, through expungement and things like that, that are clear derivatives, but things that have really impacted the entire community ecosystem and disenfranchised, as well as economically starved Black, Indigenous, and Latinx communities. And so Jeanette is going to walk you through the components of the bill, and then I'll be back to talk about the money.
Thank you, Senator. That was a really, really good setup. Economically starved, really well said, because as that arrest happened of cannabis possession, that is just so prevalent. You heard the stats, but especially in the Black community. And as that arrest and incarceration has created this trigger, for someone within the system. And that trigger has a heavy financial burden, both in the fines and fees and time outside of the workforce that someone pays while engaged directly with the criminal justice system, but also afterwards, because that record sits on you for a long time, and it impacts your ability to wealth build and the ability of your children's children to wealth build. So you've heard the stats from Representative Lawrence Spence already. And that is why the first thing that the Equity Investment Act does is, but if you read the bill, you could miss this. Because the bill spends a lot of time talking about accountability through the governing body, but there is the most important part of the bill, better way to say it, at least from the intent of our work group, was to address the economic harm and the starvation, as Representative Lawrence Spence said, or Senator Lawrence Spence said, and to address that with this community investment fund, where we are collecting 25% of cannabis taxes ongoing and 10% of the criminal fines account. Representative Lawrence Spence will actually talk about that more in a minute. And that money comes together to do this income building and wealth building within the Black, Indigenous, and Latinx communities to repair that harm. So this these investments go to community
organizations. Eat your food.
If someone could mute for us, they're feeding a baby or a dog, would be awesome. So if we invest that money into organizations who are serving Black, Indigenous, and Latinx communities as priority, and they ensure that that money goes to help, as I said, create that wealth and income building into programs like land ownership and home ownership, job placement and education, business funding and support, both for cannabis businesses and non-cannabis businesses, as well as child care, high quality child care. And we ask that existing tax dollars that are going to OHA and the state school fund are tailored to be focused on equity, tailored to ensure that those monies reach the communities who have the biggest equity gaps in education and in mental and physical health, again, Black, Indigenous, and Latinx communities. So this community investment fund really is the heart of this bill. And as I walk through the other parts of it, I will step you through how we support the community investment for the long term. I also want to say as I move forward that what we did as a work group was really took a lot of experiences and expertise as learned from other states, because we're following along with cannabis equity. We're adding it after the fact. Most states are legalizing recreational cannabis and including cannabis, essentially what we now call cannabis equity. And we took from those best practices as a work group and really tried to create the most effective legislation that we could. So I did want to center the discussion in terms of where we were coming along in the cannabis equity journey. The community investment is an important part of cannabis equity legislation, and New York actually just passed with 40% set aside for these investments. The next piece of cannabis equity legislation also includes equity licenses. And we were looking at ensuring those licenses were for the communities we were setting out to impact, for Black, Indigenous, and Latinx communities. And we were thinking about what are the hurdles that entrepreneurs, largely the same hurdles that all undercapitalized entrepreneurs face when entering the cannabis industry. And so these equity licenses are for recreational cannabis licenses. And there's an equity license variant, if you will, for every cannabis equity license that the OLCC currently has. And those licenses come with significantly reduced fees. They come with faster time to process a license, because that processing time really just represents an expense of capital that undercapitalized entrepreneurs don't have. And these licenses come with additional support from the OLCC. The Cannabis Equity Fund, or the investment fund, funds that additional support from the OLCC. The other thing we have as part of these licenses is the introduction of two new licenses. So one of those licenses is a delivery license, an expanded delivery license, or a delivery license for the first time. Today we have a delivery certificate. This will be our first OLCC delivery license. The delivery license is a really important business model for the undercapitalized entrepreneur. And so this delivery license will just set that license up to be a business model that just makes a little bit more sense and has a little bit more room to grow. And this license will be for equity licensees for 6 years, plus grandfathering in existing standalone delivery licensees today. The second license that we're introducing here for equity licensees for 6 years is an on-premise consumption license. And this is really important to legalize cannabis for everyone. So today, if you rent, or if you're a veteran in VA housing, or if you're in public assistance, you don't have a place functionally where you can legally smoke cannabis. It just doesn't exist. So that's a problem we need to address. And these social consumption licenses or on-premise licenses get us there. We also have added a shared kitchen, shared processing license, a third license type in this bill, and that is available for everyone. It's a license that used to exist and went away, and now we're making it an official license. It will be here for good. And it's just really great for all undercapitalized entrepreneurs to share that most expensive kind of facility cost. Cannabis expungement is next, and let's, you know, there is we talked about the burden of having this offense on your record. And we currently have about 28,000 cannabis possession records that would be eligible for consideration for expungement. And today we're just not getting those off people's records. We have some rapid expungement laws on the books today, but when the work group formed, we had Senator Lou Frederick on, who SB 420, our rapid expungement law, was the bill he championed. You know, he was with us in saying we can go further, and now is the time. So going further with cannabis expungement means really meeting a standard also set by other cities and states for automatic expungement of cannabis crimes. And what that means is it's not automatic. It means we're setting aside money from the equity fund to fund the paperwork and the people necessary to find these records, but then to get them off of people's, get free people of these charges automatically. So people no longer have to contact an attorney or fill out paperwork. This will be processed for them. The other thing we're doing that is unique pushes us forward with this is fines and fees. So we are all expunging everyone, even if you owe fines and fees. And for those most at the margins economically, paying those mounting fines and fees, because you continue to pay fees if you don't pay the fine, those accrue. People don't get they don't expunge because they don't have the extra income to deal with the fines and fees first. So we're saying you get expunged even if you still owe fines and fees. And that, I think, is really important for what we're talking about, which are cannabis possession crimes no longer illegal. The other thing that we're doing is we're addressing something that is a hidden burden for women. So I saw this a lot in my expungement clinic work, and I know other people have. We've heard stories from other many people who've seen this, where you start to expunge and you find that women with possession charges also come with child endangerment charges, even if their children aren't home at the time of consumption. And it's a particular burden that women carry that then impacts their ability to work in childcare, their ability to work in a nursing home, or even serve on the PTA. So that's something that we believe needs to also be addressed for people so they're truly free of both burdens. And in this case, we're talking about a specific burden that impacts women. The last thing I'll share with you is that the Equity Investment and Accountability Office and Board is a large part of really the words on paper in the bill, but that's important because we understand that the sustainability and success of these kinds of programs requires thoughtful oversight. So this Equity Investment and Accountability Office and Board is an office of a few people that will sit within the Governor's Office of Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion. And then it's a volunteer board of 9 to 12 people, I believe. And those folks are together, the board and the office, responsible for driving to accountability, ensuring that the investment of the funds reach the communities we intended and are having improved outcomes. And they're going to do that by looking at a lot of data and requesting a lot of data and tracking, really, again, tracking those funds using data to see who did they impact and are we having the kind of shift and economic improvements that we expect. I never was able to share my video with you, but as I turn it back over to Representative Kasha Lawrence Spence, I hope that she is able to do so.
I can.
Yay.
Thank you so much, Jeanette. So now I'm here to talk about the money. So one of the things that we did in this work group was we not only invited our private sphere partners, but we invited our public sphere partners. So our agency partners. So the OLCC, OPDS, the DOJ, all of these agencies were a part of this work group, including legislative revenue. And so this report of the Cannabis Equity Fund will be comprised of is based on the legislative revenue forecast for December of 2020, right? 2020, the years passed by. And so this forecast has since increased, and so it's growing. So that is the beauty of this Cannabis Equity Fund and this bill is that we're creating a truly generative form of investment into our community, that it's not gonna be static, right? Taking a 25% distribution of our cannabis tax revenue ensures that as the revenues increase, so does our community's share of that revenue. So as it stands, based on that forecast of $319 million coming into the state in cannabis tax revenue, we're taking 25% of that pre-allocation. And so that equates to around $80 million. We're also going to be taking around 10% of the criminal fines account. And that's gonna give us a total of $8 million. Why are we taking money from the criminal fines account? One of the things that Jeanette already talked about was the debt burden that is on people who have previously been incarcerated or have been in custody due to a cannabis crime. So the average person who has been previously incarcerated is in debt to the state. I want you to go back one, please. Is in debt to the state. One more. Is in debt to the state over $15,000. And so that money, comes through with, is a part of their sentencing, can be restitution, but it's also the fact that you have to pay to be paroled. In the state of Oregon, that's upwards of $35 a week. You also have to pay every time they drug test you and every time they come out to your home. So not only have you been, you have a felony, it's hard to get a job. You can apply for FAFSA. You can apply for an SBA loan. You have very limited modalities to economically mobilize, and yet and still they're creating debt burden for you and a debt kind of prison because it's hard to get out of it because it incurs fees, it incurs fines, and it incurs interest. So we're taking some of that money back and putting that into this fund as well. Currently, the state police receive around $13.5 million of cannabis tax revenue. Our original intention was to, absorb all of that money, but now it's going to be rerouted with very specific language to fund the expungement costs and programs. So we're trying to ensure that that money is not going to continue to arrest Black and Brown people for cannabis, like smoking cannabis outdoors or doing it in a manner that is up to their discretion, but is going to go to really relieving our communities of the burden of cannabis criminalization and investing in us. So again, the total of this fund as it stood in December of 2020 would be $101 million and growing to fund homeownership programs. So it's gonna go directly from that office that it's gonna sit in the governor's office to our community-based organizations to fund homeownership, to fund land ownership, to go to our Student Success Act, to go to job training and entrepreneurship in the cannabis industry and without. So again, this is a truly holistic bill. It is truly reparative. It is looking holistically at the ways in which cannabis criminalization and the war on drugs has impacted our communities and is finding the modalities to rectify those injustices and that harm. And I'll stop there.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So if you could make me host, I am going to introduce, we have a couple of panelists coming up next who are representing communities that will benefit from the, or potentially benefit from the investment fund and from the equity licenses. So. And are you able to make me host, Senator Lauren Spence?
Okay, I'll try.
Okay.
Done.
Yay. Okay, fabulous. Okay, great. Great, so I think you guys can see my video now. And I have the opportunity to introduce our next speaker, who is Portia Mittens. And Portia Mittens is the owner of the Coffee Pot. And it is a minority, she's a dispensary owner of the Coffee Pot in Sumter, Oregon. And she knows firsthand the challenges of really setting up a business as a founder facing a number of hurdles. So I am happy to turn it over to her so that she can share with you her thoughts on the bill. Okay. So Portia, I know you are over here now as a panelist, but so another technical glitch, all of our panelists have the same name.
So, can you hear me?
Beautiful, yes.
Okay, I'm speaking, but my video won't start, but that's okay.
That's okay, you will, because I'm gonna make you the host.
Okay.
And then when you are done, you will make John Washington the host.
Okay. All right, can you all see me?
Yes.
All right. Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight to talk about this new bill. And I'm Portia Mittens, one of the owners of the Coffee Pot. And my partner is actually another woman who has had drug possession charges as well. So we sort of cover the gamut of all the things. And so the reason I support this bill and why this bill is so important and I'm so passionate about it is, one is because it's kind of a selfish reason, but not really, but it really would have helped me when we were setting up our dispensary, getting additional help from the OLCC, because I had never done anything like this in my life. And then additional money, because you can't get funding. It's really hard to raise money, especially when you're like brand new to cannabis and people are like, why am I gonna give you $100,000 cash? No, even when they have it. And so I had to self-fund and I had to really pull from every which way that I could pull from. And I think this is so important because I don't want other people to have to go through that much stress to get something that we should be in already. I meet so many people who say, man, I wish I could do what you're doing. I wish there was a way. And it hurts me because it shouldn't be a wish. It should be a true possibility. It should be something that people can really believe they can achieve. You know, there's a saying, you have to see it in order to be it. I don't agree with that because, you know, if you have to see it, who's going to be the first? But when they do see it and then they still feel like they can't be it, it's heartbreaking. And so having this bill, having this money, because money is real, having the support is going to be life-changing for so many people. I am one of the few Black cannabis dispensary owners in the state. I don't know if there's more than five. If there's more than five, please correct me. I hope there is. But if there isn't, that's really sad, because we opened our dispensary in 2017 and it is now 2021 or is it 22 yet? The years go so fast, as Akasha Spence said, but it should not matter. Like within 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, there should be more people there. And since it isn't, we need to do our part to get more people in. And cannabis is not the end. Having a dispensary, having a business is not the end, it's the beginning, because we need a healthy ecosystem. We don't just need people making money, but we need our communities to be healthy. We need our communities to be whole, because when our communities are whole, then it makes our world becomes more whole. Everything, it becomes more safe. When people can provide food for their family, when people can provide safety for their family, it just really changes their outlook on life, period, which is a better thing for everyone. When people feel like they have something to live for and they feel like they can do it, that is where the change comes in. And this bill helps do that. And that is why I support it wholeheartedly, because I want to see more people win. You know, I always jokingly tell my friends, because people, I'm so free with giving information and helping people. And people are like, why would you do that? They're your competition. I'm like, first of all, I can't sell all the weed anyway. Rick Ross tried it and he failed. So many have tried and failed. We can't do it alone. We have to do this together. And because of that, I am a huge proponent of this bill. And I hope that you all will join us in this fight as we look to grow not just the cannabis industry, but our ecosystem.
Thank you, Portia.
You are welcome.
Okay, so I'm gonna ask John Washington to speak so that we can identify where he is and you can make him the host.
I am here. Hello.
He's Fawn. Are you Fawn?
I'm Fawn today. Am I Fawn? Maybe I am. Let's see.
No. Okay. So where do I go to make him a host?
So you go beside his name, which is right underneath yours right now, which is
okay.
Is not yours, but you see that.
And make then, host.
Yes. Beautiful.
Change host. All right.
Let's see which one I am. Let's see here. Can you guys hear me? Ladies, can you hear me?
Yes. Yes, you sound great.
Okay, great, great, great. I just rolled over from the hab. I've been on for the last 4 hours on something else, but I do appreciate this opportunity to jump off of that and to come over here. And I was listening to a few things you guys are saying. And so now what's this thing about Senator Lawrence Spence?
Yes, let's acknowledge. So Representative Lauren Spence, whose office spearheaded the launch of this work group this summer and then was the engine that drove it, is now wonderfully running for a Senate seat.
She's everywhere. I just can't catch up with her. But anyway.
Well, why don't I introduce you properly? Because you deserve your proper introduction. And then hopefully you can start your video and you can share your face with us. So John Washington is owner and editor-in-chief of Flossed Media and executive director of the Soul District, Portland's business district representing the largest number of Black business owners in Portland. And this is in, of course, historic North Northeast Portland. So thank you for being with us, Mr. Washington. I'll turn it to you.
My pleasure. And thank you both again. Hello, everyone, tonight. Thank you, Jeanette Horton, and all the representatives, all the fine folks who worked so tirelessly to construct the Oregon Cannabis Equity Act, HB 3112, and who organized this event. I'm honored to be here. Hi, I'm John Washington, as I've been introduced already. I'm the CEO and editor-in-chief of Flossed Media, the executive director also of the Soul District Business Association. The Soul District is one of the oldest, largest, and culturally diverse business districts in Oregon, with regards to small Black-owned businesses and their involvement. Our organization is dedicated to advancing the civic and economic rights and resources for African Americans in Oregon. I'm also a board chair of a coalition of African Americans for cannabis, for marijuana equity. CAME is an organization that facilitates education, training, and advocacy for Black business owners who are involved and who want to become involved in the cannabis industry. Also, all the organizations I represent would like to acknowledge that the tireless work on behalf of the cannabis legislation has changed the lives of millions for the better. By opening up opportunities and economic prosperity and relieving individuals from the burden of marijuana convictions through expungement procedures. While we celebrate these hard-won victories, it is incumbent upon us to remember that it was a decade ago when former head of the DEA, Harry Angeler, has cited the primary reasons to outlaw marijuana is its effects on degenerate races. Of course, he was referring to Black, Hispanic, and other communities of color. The same one who bore the burden of the war on drugs that we've heard, and who compromised and the disproportionate number of more than 60 million arrested. And you know, and as I look back on this, I remember serving on Ted Kulongoski's Measure 11 task force, where they had been going after gang members for quite some time. And you'd be amazed at how many of them they were able to get on the marijuana charges. So while the legalization of cannabis in this state has shifted the downward spiral of criminalization for our BIPOC community, we're still miles behind the economically. Our more fully resourced, predominantly white counterparts are better positioned financially and resources with the type of business structures needed to be intact in order to get out the gate and running. You know, and that leads me to a story or a thought that I heard, a story that I heard on the TV the other day. And it talked about how there was a guy down in California who had 1 million square feet of glass greenhouse. And his business essentially all by himself can provide marijuana to all 50 states in the United States. One man, one white man who owns that much asset. Our community is constantly being disrupted from our prosperity. When we launch our businesses, we are always under extra scrutiny and our capabilities are always being questioned. This causes delays that lead to frustrations and affects our business and personal welfare. It took a special set of circumstances to get us here, and it's going to take a real special set of circumstances to get us out. And I'd like to respectfully support this bill in this act, this cannabis equity legislation, and I would like to support you all in what it is that you're doing. The need to begin reparations and this need to be unfettered and by the oversight of the original constructs that led us to our own demise. So what I just wanted to say, I said this to say this, is that, look, we've been getting our butts kicked out there in the field for quite a long time around this marijuana issue. And it was much like the time when we thought about the digital divide also, when those old boys got on that digital train and drove all down the track and left us all behind. And then realized that it didn't have any kind of other people on the train and it had to stop. And it had to come back and pick up some other people. And I think that this cannabis thing did a similar thing. It got out the gate and it had some good intentions in mind. But again, as usual, it forgets about us. And so I'm so glad that you guys are being a constant reminder that they need to get their game in order so that they can make sure that some of this equity or this equitable distribution of wealth is coming to our people. So thank you very much for allowing me to come in and share with you a little bit about my perspective about this. And I do appreciate the work you ladies are doing.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Your perspective is spot on, and we always appreciate you sharing. Okay. I am going to ask you to give hosting capabilities to the next person.
And how do I do that?
Well, let's find out where he is. So Jeff Sugarman is our next speaker. And Jeff, if you can. Speak or raise your hand. So it looks like Jeff is under the attendees. All right, Mr. Washington. If you look to the right of your screen, you're going to see panelists and attendees.
I lost my mouse.
Oh, all right. Well,
you're going to have to do it.
Okay, great. Can you give me, that's easy. Let's give me hosting capabilities. You'll still need your mouse though.
You know, Fawn's running around here shifting stuff. Shifting stuff around. Took my damn mouse.
Imagine.
Yeah. So what do you
Hi,
want?
Hello.
What would you like me to do?
So you gotta go.
So go to my name there and click those blue kind of, there's gonna be more.
Your Bob, name?
Are you doing it or should I walk through this? Make me the host right next to my name.
Okay, you have a host. You are the host. Change the host?
Yes.
Nice, yes, beautiful.
There you go, you got
Thank
it.
Thank you so much, okay. Thank you. Appreciate you and your wisdom. I'm so thankful for what Mr. Washington and all the folks at the Soul District have been able to share with us and make clear to us about just the journey that Black business owners have gone on in Portland. All right, so here we go. Our next speaker is going to be Jeff Sugarman. Jeff Sugarman is Chief Compliance Officer of Groundworks Industries and has been an active member of this work group since the beginning. I call him the OG of Oregon cannabis because he has been an active member of advancing of the kind of really core people on the ground advancing legalization in Oregon since Measure 91 and before. So Jeff, could you speak so I know which person you are? Everyone's got.
Yep, I'm here, Jeanette.
There you are. All right, beautiful. So I'm going to promote you to host so people can see you.
There we go. Hello, everyone. Greetings. Thank you for coming tonight and spending some time with us. You know, it was about a year ago that I attended my first meeting of the Equity Coalition. And I have to say, this coalition has been one of the most inclusive and effective groups I've ever worked with in my 30 plus years of political work. I think what makes it so special is that it's more than just cannabis companies, although we have great industry support. It's more than our legislative allies, although we are incredibly grateful for the work of elected officials, including former Rep, future Senator Akasha Lawrence Spence, Rep Fahey, Senator Jama, and more. It's more than groups like the Urban League and the Cascade AIDS Project who are strong supporters. And it's more than incredible Willamette University law students like Brett Mulligan who have generated really important work for this effort. So this is truly a coalition that has come together to create what I think will become the standard for equity programs nationwide. I'm thankful to be a part of this team and grateful that Groundworks and some of our other great donors like Wild and Weed Maps have not only provided the financial support we needed, but have allowed many of us to use significant time out of our regular work days to participate. I want to share a quick story that, at least for me, really brought home the importance of this work. Last weekend, while I was visiting family in Ohio, I went to the Maltz Holocaust Museum in Cleveland to see an exhibit about the life of Ruth Bader Ginsburg. But as I wandered through the exhibit, I ran across a panel dedicated to another woman from that era, someone who inspired Ruth Bader Ginsburg early in her career, a person that I had never heard of before, Pauli Murray. As a young child growing up in Maryland and North Carolina, Polly experienced firsthand the racism and gender discrimination that dominated life in the 20s and 30s and 40s and right up until today. Marie's father was murdered by police. It didn't deter Marie, it inspired her. So at the age of 16, she moved to New York City and attended Hunter College, graduating in 1933. In 1940, she sat in a whites-only section of a Virginia bus with a friend, and they were arrested for violating state segregation laws. That was 15 years before Rosa Parks. That didn't stop Murray. She enrolled in law school at Howard University with the help of Thurgood Marshall, where she coined the phrase Jane Crow, alluding to the Jim Crow laws that enforced racial segregation in the Southern United States. She graduated first in her class, but was denied the chance to do postgraduate work at Harvard University because of her gender. But still, she persevered and is credited with finding the constitutional path that ended separate but equal discrimination in the United States. She earned a master's degree from UC Berkeley, and she became the first African American to receive a law degree from Yale Law School. As a lawyer, she argued for civil rights and women's rights. The National Organization for Colored People, NAACP Chief Counsel Thurgood Marshall, called Murray's 1950 book, State Laws on Race and Color, the Bible of the Civil Rights Movement. She served on the 1961 Presidential Commission on the Status of Women, appointed by John Kennedy. She was a co-founder of the National Organization of Women. Ruth Bader Ginsburg named her a co-author of a brief in 1971 in the case of Reed versus Reed in recognition of her pioneering work on gender discrimination. And she became the first Black woman ordained as an Episcopalian priest in 1977. And yet with such an impressive record, equally as impressive in my mind as Ruth Bader Ginsburg, I had never heard of Murray, and I bet most of you haven't either. And it brought home to me so clearly why we are engaged in this fight for equity. For too long, our country has shunted aside the accomplishments of people like Pauli Murray. If through this Equity Investment Act, we can reach out to people who have been victimized by the same racism and sexism Murray faced and find ways to help them grow and succeed in their communities, maybe just removing one or two of the barriers placed in their path, and maybe someday we'll be saying, we knew them when. And if we can accomplish, if what we accomplish makes a difference in the lives of families and individuals and communities, then we really have done important work together. I am so honored and grateful to be a part of this coalition. I am proud of the cannabis industry for its incredible support. And I'm frankly in awe of people like Representative Lauren Spence and Jeanette Ward Horton and Deshita Dawson and Dr. Rachel Knox for their leadership. In my 30 years of working in politics, I have never seen such a broad-based and diverse coalition come together to produce such a thoughtful and complete piece of legislation. And so now what remains is the toughest task of all, getting the bill to the desk of Governor Brown. So how can you help? You can go to the webpage and sign our petition in support of HB 3112. You can join Wild and Weed Maps and Dutchie and Siren and Gleam Law and Emerge Law and Groundworks and Mendy and dozens of other companies and individuals who have donated to our political action committee. You can write a letter to your legislators or a letter to the editor of your local paper, and stay tuned because we will have many more asks of you as we go forward. I thank you all for joining us here tonight and allowing me to speak, and thank you for your support of House Bill 3112.
Thank you, Jeff. Okay, Jeff, your task is to turn host over to Jesse Bonacue. While you're doing that, I want to excitedly announce our first raffle winner. So we had a raffle for the first person to give while on the call. And I'm excited to say that is Lisa Snyder of Tokativity. Everyone, that was excitement. So Lisa, you are on your way to getting an amazing gift basket you're going to absolutely love, filled with wonderful BIPOC-owned businesses, all supported by New Leaf Project. Yay! I've seen other donations come in. Thank you, everybody. So everyone who's donated will be entered into the raffle that we'll announce before we close. So keep giving. Thank you.
Am I the host? Thank you all. I hope you all can hear me. My name is Jesse Bonneke with the Oregon Retailers of Cannabis Association. And it is my pleasure to introduce our legislative speakers tonight. I'm going to introduce them all, but as the legislative session has taken some weird turns this year, COVID times, we might have to be a little bit flexible as they may be called back onto the floor. And so I'm going to introduce them all at first, and then we'll see who's available when to begin speaking. First of all, I do want to call out all of the folks who have all of our legislative sponsors that have been working to support us and fighting for us with our colleagues in committee and just showing us the love, which we deeply appreciate. And so our chief sponsors are Representative Ricky Weiss, Representative Janelle Bynum, Senator Lou Frederick, Representative Mark Meek, and then of course, the three you're gonna hear from tonight, Senator Casey Jama, Rep. Julie Fahey, Rep. Karen Power. On top of that, we have several other sponsors, Representative Teresa Alonzo Leon, Representative Ken Helm, Rep. Maxine Dexter, Rep. Pam Marsh, Rep. Zach Husband, Rep. Confam, and Rep. Lisa Reynolds. It just wanna say thank you to all of them. And if you ever have the opportunity yourselves to send them a note of appreciation, please do. It is so important that they hear not just from us when we want them to do something different than they're currently doing, but when we show them support for supporting the things that we care so deeply about. With that, it's my pleasure to introduce all of our speakers tonight, starting with Senator Casey Jama, who is actually my personal senator, which I'm very proud of, and can't wait to get to know him a little bit better. Senator Jama represents District 24, representing East Portland and North Clackamas. He is the first Muslim and former refugee to serve in the Oregon Senate. Before joining the Oregon Senate this year, he spent 19 years fighting for social justice, social and economic justice with Unite Oregon, which he also co-founded, the Western State Center, Fair Shot for All, and the Oregon Health Equity Alliance. We also have up on tonight Representative Karen Power, House District 41. She's representing Milwaukee and she's right next to me. I'm only a couple blocks away from her being my representative. She was first elected to the Oregon House in 2016 and has been a constant champion for the environment, public housing, public education, and equity. In addition to being representative, she's also general counsel at Freshwater Trust. And then, of course, Representative Julie Fahey, House District 14, representing Eugene area and Junction City. Representative Fahey introduced the first draft of this bill in the in the last legislative session. And we're just so very grateful for her constant dedication and supporting this bill over the last year, supporting the coalition, and providing invaluable insight and wisdom as we move forward through the legislative process. And just really appreciate that. One more just note before I introduce Senator Jama, wanted to remind everybody that please do use the links that we've been posting in the chat to contribute. Also, if you have any questions for the either the senator or representatives, please put those in the chat. We'll be monitoring those. And after they're done introducing themselves, we'll try and run through some of the questions that you all have. So again, please put questions in the chat. And don't forget to make a contribution. And thank you so much for your time. So with that, I'm going to turn this over to Senator Jama. And Senator Jama, I'm going to make you the host. And when you're done speaking, just please make me the host again.
Thank you, Jesse, and thank you, everyone. Good evening. Again, my name is Casey Jama. I'm Senate District 24. I use he, him pronouns. Let me start with this one first. I do appreciate all the work that went into this bill and all the, before I joined the crowd, but also particularly the leadership of future Senator Akasha Lawrence Spencer and Representative Julie Fahey, as well as Representative Power, and of course, all the organizations and all the leaders who are leading this effort and making sure that we take this bill to the finish line. I do appreciate all your efforts. I won't take much of your time. I am gonna take a couple of minutes just to share with you why do I support this bill and why it's so important to make sure that we pass this legislator and Senator Governor Brown's desk. You know, as a former refugee and also a Black immigrant, refugee Muslim, I faced my own way of profiling. I've been stopped multiple times as I've been in Portland, Oregon for, in many cases. And of course, the first thing the folks, the police officers do is really pat me down and making sure that I have anything in my pockets. And of course, I know what they're looking for. So I have been long history of commitment of criminal justice reform. And I'll tell you this, you know, the first time that I, you know, really saw this data was a few years back, 2017, when I was pushing as activist a House bill that was trying to eliminate racial profiling in the state level, House Bill 2355. That was also half of the portion of that bill was also addressing drug possessions and creating a space where, you know, the folks are not charged in felony conviction, felony, but rather than being lowered down to misdemeanor charges if someone is being caught a small amount of usable drugs. But one thing that really struck me for that bill, as I was working with the legislatures and also work group, is that the data that have been set up for us in front of us was one thing. No matter which racial group that you can pick, Black, you know, Latinx, Native American, white, Asian Pacific Islander, we use drugs across the board equally. I think 2% of the population, any ethnic group, that's kind of what we've been given statistically. But then when you look who's been charged and who's been convicted, the racial disparity is very clear. Black and brown folks are extremely criminalized in terms of this issue. And so for me, that's when it's the first time I recognized the intersection between war on drugs and how we police, and of course, and how we convict people who are, you know, on possession of a limited amount of quantity of drugs. So that's really, for me, the genesis of why I finally decided to pay attention into this issue and how it cross sectors with the other issues, economic justice issues as well. So I was really excited when I heard about this bill and when I was asked to support this bill, because again, those elements really that I mentioned about upstream model wise, in terms of the public health, in terms of the war on drugs, in terms of the economic justice, those are all the elements that this bill is addressing to ensure that there's equity in our community. So as also chair of the housing, I really, really appreciate that this bill is also allocating resources to address home ownership in our brown and Black community, as well as, of course, addressing some of the economic disparities by supporting our local Black and brown owned businesses. So my support, as that's really the fundamentally why I think I believe the economic justice and criminal justice reform has to intersect with each other. There's two things that I care most about it. It's about policy changes that really impact racial justice. And then of course, resources and money that follows with those policies. Those are if we don't have those two elements of in our policies, then we definitely won't make the impact that we want. With that said, I also wanna highlight and again, thank all the folks who are pushing this issue. I will do my best I can to support making sure that we take this bill to the finish line. But also I wanna also ensure and realize that, you know, as a Black and immigrant refugee leader, I think we need to ensure that whatever we do to make sure that we carve and address the economic disparities, both Black and brown people, and particularly as it relates to criminal justice reform. Those are the commitments that I made it. And I think I'm grateful to be part of this work. And I'm so glad that there's so many organizations, Urban League and other folks who are working on this issue. With that said, thank you so much, all you do. And if there's anything that I can do to support this bill, and I will let you know one thing. I know you're already doing this, but if you can continuously advocating on the people who are the Senate side, and of course, people who are my colleagues, who might not hear this issue as much as I do. I think those are some of the things that I can ask folks to contribute and make sure that the discussion is happening on all the government levels, particularly on the Senate side and the House side as well. With that said, thank you, and I'm happy to answer any questions, but also great work, and I'm so excited and to be grateful to be part of this coalition. Thank you so much. Let me find out how I can make you host, Jesse, again. So that will be my challenge.
Thank you, Senator, and thank you for your passion. If you see my name on the right, just click on the more button next to my name as you hold the mouse over it.
It's all yours.
And please stay on if you can. We're gonna introduce the representatives and then do Q&A. So with that, I definitely see Representative Fahey. And so Representative, I hope you are ready, and I'm gonna make you the host. And then just please make me the host when you're finished.
Great. Oh, good. There's my video. Hi, everyone. I am Representative Julie Fahey, and I think Rep. Karen Power is in the car driving, so she might not be ready yet. So I am taking over for her right now. Thanks, everyone, for joining tonight. It's great to see so many people logged onto the Zoom. I wish I could see all your smiling faces. We just got finished voting on the House floor for the night, so I'm happy to join you from this point on. So as Jesse said, I introduced a version of this bill last year in the 2020 short session. and before that, I was one of the legislators. When I came into the legislature in 2017, I was put on the Joint Committee on Marijuana Regulation. So the committee had been up and running for a few years at that point. But I was really interested in this in taking on this topic and doing what I could to try to help set up an equitable regulation system. It became pretty clear after I was on that committee that while Oregon was sort of ahead of the curve in terms of being one of the first states, obviously, to legalize medical cannabis, but certainly to legalize adult use cannabis as well, we were behind the curve when it came to equity. As we've seen more and more states legalize recreational cannabis every year, many states and localities have chosen to take equity into account when they've designed their regulations for this new industry. So at least 8 states have established some kind of cannabis social equity program that is intended to recognize and address the disproportionate burden that cannabis prohibition had on communities of color and other communities in those states. But Oregon did not do that. When we set up our newly legal system, the policies that we designed did not reckon with the harm of prohibition. And I think I've heard Jeff speak on this before, and he's spoken very clearly and plainly about how we did not have the right people at the table at that time. And so I saw Jeanette speak at an event, I think in the fall of 2019, and was so inspired that I said, I will do whatever Jeanette wants in terms of social equity. We need to get this done in Oregon, and put forward a bill in 2020 session, which did not pass in part because of the walkout, the Republican walkout. And then after that session, Rep. Akasha Lawrence Spence really took the reins on this issue. And she and Jeanette and Nikki ran one of the most impressive work group and community engagement processes that I have ever seen in my time in the legislature. It is absolutely because of their efforts on this that the bill that we are talking about tonight reflects the input not just of sort of the typical people that you see in the Oregon State Capitol, but truly reflects the input of the community and the people who live these realities every day. So entrepreneurs, community advocates, industry players, and people who have been impacted by the harms of prohibition. So that process was really impressive, and I'm so grateful to Rep. Lauren Spence for, and hopefully soon Senator Lauren Spence, for running that process. I will also say that that community engagement process really shifted the emphasis from the bill that I put forward in 2020 being about, you know, reducing barriers to people entering the legal cannabis market, you know, technical assistance, reduce fees and licenses, to really one that more broadly is intended to undo the harms that prohibition has done, particularly for communities of color. Everyone I'm sure on this Zoom knows that we arrested and incarcerated people of color at a disproportionate rates, and that has and will continue to impact those communities and families for generations to come. So the bill that we are working on in the legislature is about equity specifically in our regulated cannabis system, but it is also about equity more generally tied to the harms of prohibition. So I don't feel like I can articulate this enough. This is truly one of the most team effort bills that I have ever seen since I've been in the legislature. It has been, you know, from the community engagement process to just the way that it is playing out in terms of getting it across the finish line in the building. It is truly a team effort between multiple legislators and community advocates and others that have been involved in this process. So I'm honored to have some small part in that and to help get it across the finish line. It is in the Rules Committee right now, which is a committee that I sit on, House Rules. We're hoping to get one last amendment proposed to the Means Committee to help hopefully get funded on in the House and the Senate. So thanks everyone tonight. Happy to stick around if there are questions.
And you can make me host again.
Done.
Thank you very much. And is Representative Power with us today or right now?
We went long on the floor, and I know she had to jump right in the car, so I wasn't sure if she was going to be able to call in.
Representative Power, if you are on, unmute yourself and we'll let you, we can give you a moment. Otherwise, I'd like to introduce Deshita Dawson to go through some of the questions that people have been asking. Deshita has been a great advocate and works with the cannabis program for the city of Portland. And Deshita, I'm going to make you the co-host, Deshita, or the host.
And I'm going to say one thing to Representative Power: unmute yourself or raise your hand if you're in attendee land. You can't unmute yourself, I don't think, but you can raise your hand and we can see you. Okay, sorry for that interruption.
And then just one last final thing, please. If you have any questions, put them in the chat.
Wow, that was powerful. Thank you so much, Jesse, and everyone else in terms of just sharing so much information. We do have a couple of questions in the chat. I know that we're running a bit long, and I did see that Representative Fahey started to answer a little bit of it, but folks are really interested in the timing aspect. When will this actually be put to vote is one of the questions from Carmel.
That's a great question. And it's a little, the answer is a little in the weeds about the, like, how a bill becomes a law. But, it is in a policy committee right now, which is the Rules Committee, like I said, that I sit on in the House. And we are working on one last amendment. And so we're hoping that that amendment can be done, this week, and that it will be put to a vote sometime in the next week to week and a half to go to the Ways and Means Committee. And the Ways and Means Committee is where every bill that costs money or deals with the budget has to go to get approved. So then when that, the Ways and Means Committee will consider that and then send it to the House floor for a vote. And then if time in end of May, early June, and then we would send it to the Senate for a vote. So that's a little circuitous in terms of the Schoolhouse Rocks, how a bill becomes a law, but that is sort of what has to happen. And in terms of the other question I saw in the Q&A about advocacy, and how much support it needs to get it over the line. So I think the biggest challenge will come in the Ways and Means Committee. I have confidence that the Rules Committee will be, we can get it out of the Rules Committee, no problem. But, you know, if you are a constituent of the co-chairs of the Joint Ways and Means Committee, so that would be Representative Rehfield, Senator Steiner-Hewitt, Word, or Senator Johnson, those folks would be great people to advocate with.
Thank you for that. I had a couple of questions that were not necessarily in the chat, but just thinking about what was covered, it was so comprehensive, but some folks have already asked me about really, if the bill passes, right, we're leaning positively, it's had so much support, how quickly do we expect some of the elements within the bill to actually come into play? And more specifically, does the bill include any timing requirements?
I can answer that, Dashita. This is Jeanette. So the bill does include timing requirements. That's a great question. That's something the work group considered, because we know that Illinois had ran into issues with that, where they didn't have timing requirements and things kind of drug on. So we'll start with the equity licenses. Those have to begin, meaning that you can start to apply for equity licenses by March of 2022. Is that next year? Yes, March of 2022. And we have requirements for the start of the equity office and board as well, within a certain number of days after passage. So there's also requirements for the start and completion of the expungement work. So all the major pieces of the bill did come with timing requirements.
Awesome. Just checking the chat really quickly to see if there are any additional questions. I have one more, but it feels like more of a closing question, because I think, again, so much work has been done to this point related to the bill. It is very comprehensive. I myself, from my experience, have just seen so many mistakes. And I think we worked really hard as a group to kind of highlight where we could, you know, really put forth the most comprehensive parts of the bill. But in terms of a question that sort of maybe a little bit of a closing question, but is there anything in the bill or not in the bill that you wish was there? And you know, how do we potentially tackle that in the future, if at all?
That's a great question.
That's a good question. Jeanette.
This was talking.
Go ahead.
Do you want to answer Rep. Fahey, please? Happy to, unless you want.
I will go. Why don't you go first, and then I'll jump in if you don't say what I'm going to say.
All right. So we've got a couple of things. We probably won't. I would love to hear what you have to say. So the two things for me are one. Well, gracious. Okay, there's so many, but I'll stick with specifically thinking about the. You know what, I lost it. I'm turning it over to you, Rep. Fahey. So the first thing that comes to mind is the OSP funds. And you know, thinking about what are the opportunities for further having those funds do work. And that's something that we could come at later. Also the on-premise licenses. I am sure that once we get those up and running and that feels, people see how that's working well, that we'll have the opportunity to expand how those licenses function. Today, our amendment says that this is only for consuming outside in an enclosed space, not viewable to the public. And that's a good start for on-premise consumption, smoking and vaping in this outdoor space. But we would like to see that be closer to what other states and cities are passing, come with a full on-premise license. Okay.
Jeanette, that's the piece about on-premise consumption is one of the things that I was going to say. I think that is an issue that, you know, the legislature has been somewhat hesitant about in previous sessions. And so we're starting sort of small and narrow and hopefully in a way that won't, you know, be intimidating. I would also say this is a very big, very broad comment, but I would also say generally, I think we need to have a total rethinking. Like if I could go back in time and just create a law free of having to put it to the ballot or to a vote or anything like that, I'm not quite sure we would have gotten to where we are now in terms of how that funding is allocated. So that would be the second thing that I would say. And then finally, I don't know if I'm frozen. Other people seem to be frozen. I feel like you all can hear me. The final thing I would say is that,
Uh-oh, I think we just lost Representative Fahey.
Yeah.
Senator Jarman, looks like you wanted to say something. Maybe you could jump in really quickly because we just lost her. She'll probably have to log back in.
Sure. I guess my comments will be very simple, and this Janet will correct me if it's not on the bill, but I also believe that I think cannabis tax revenue will soon going to be one of the largest tax income in the state. It probably will take from over on the alcohol. I do believe that in some next few years, because overall, I think also we will become export state when it's the statewide, not nationwide, become legal. So we are ahead of the game. So I think my hope is that because of that, the amount of the potential that I hope that will be there. So we incrementally to increase the resources on the, so when it's the revenue tax increases, if we can increase the amount of that we allocate on this bill, that would be one suggestion would have been exciting. But if it's already there, great. But that would be one it will excite me most.
Well, it's definitely, that's a great point. And I think that's why we're really adamant about it being a percentage of the tax revenue as opposed to a hard number that doesn't change. But you're absolutely right, Senator, because Illinois just announced that their cannabis tax revenue has now eclipsed their alcohol tax revenue for the state. So we're all it will be moving towards that direction. So I think that's a great point. And it's good that we are at least in position to always benefit from the tax revenue growing. I don't know if we're going to get Representative Fahey back, but what I will say is that I'm looking through the chat. I don't see too many other questions, but I know we ran a bit long. I'm going to pass the mic over to Jesse. Hi, and I'm going to, I guess I have to give you back the host capabilities, but if there are questions as, oh, she's back. Okay.
Back.
Awesome. Yay. There you go.
I don't know what you heard of what I said about, but about what I wish was in the bill, but I agreed with Jeanette about on-site consumption. And I do feel like there should be a rethinking more broadly of sort of cannabis tax dollars allocation and how that gets distributed. You know, I'm not really sure it makes sense for cannabis tax dollars to go to schools anymore. And so, you know, not that's not going to be in this bill, but I would love to take a step back. And then the other piece I would just say on that question was, we have certain constitutional requirements that we have to fulfill anytime we're using race-specific language. So there is something called the Equal Protection Clause of the Constitution, where if you call out, use race-specific language in a law, it has to meet certain tests of in order to be held as constitutional. And many times, several times throughout this process, I have found myself wishing that we were not constrained by that, the types of language we could use in that way. And so, and that we challenged in court. So I think we've done a very good job of sort of threading the needle to make sure the bill is constitutional and it will pass muster. But it is, you know, it is just one of the constraints that we're operating under in terms of the language that we could use in the bill.
That's a great point. And again, shout out to Brett and all of the work that was done as we started putting together that legislative report to try to stay within those boundaries. But I think we've shown time and time again that race neutral language isn't necessarily getting where we need to go with really establishing equity or at least starting on the path. And so I'm excited about what is in the bill, because it still is precedent setting. Even now, as we talk about the New York legalization, which was really great to see that 40% cannabis tax revenue, it isn't as well defined as this bill in terms of where it will go. Although I think most of the legislators are aware of the intent behind it. All right, I'm going to pass that mic over to Jesse. And yeah, thank you guys so much for the time. Let's look. I want to make you the host, and you are it.
Thank you all. And first off, I'd love to do a great call out for Rachel Weissman Holler. I hope I got that right. As the first person to give $250 and enter themselves into the $250 raffle. So with that, I'm also you're reminding everybody that there's two raffles going on. One for everybody who gives over $250, and one for everyone who gives anything, whether it's $1, $5, $10, $100, or $1,000. Of course, then you get entered in too. So please click on the link in the chat if you have the ability to give anything. Every little bit helps. And so please, it only takes a minute, and it shows your support to this effort, both now and as we move forward. With that, I'd like just to sort of take a moment to thank everybody who participated and supported it tonight and stayed with us through our technical difficulties and inspirational speakers. I have been, let me say that there is a long road ahead of us. We have, I think, all of the energy, support, and knowledge that we need, the people with the talent that we need, to carry this bill all the way to the end of session. But that doesn't mean it will be easy or that we won't need help. Obviously, we've been asking for money throughout this because money is like water. It helps things grow, and we need it. And it's essential that we don't, we have all the resources necessary to communicate with our supporters, to do outreach, to provide information to legislators, and that all takes time and work and graphic artists and other things like that. And so it's just so helpful to have all the resources we need, and so that Jeanette and the other great organizers can spend their time not raising money, but working with legislators, educating them, convincing them, and moving them to support the bill. The other thing that we're gonna need is we're gonna need your help as citizens of Oregon to reach out to legislators and talk with them and talk about why this bill is important to you. And so with that, we have the petition on the website that you can add your name to, but we would also love it if you could email the equity pack, the cannabis equity pack, if you're willing to join us in talking with legislators. And in case you're concerned, it's very easy to do. We support you. We don't leave you out in the wind all by yourself. We go over talking points, and we're often there in the room with you, but it's just so much more powerful when it's a constituent talking to a legislator and saying, this is why this bill is so important to me. As a constituent, I'm watching you, I'm asking you, and I'm looking for your support on this important issue. And it's really helpful. And you can speak on behalf of yourself as an individual, or if you own or represent a business in the area, you can speak on that business. So again, it's in the chat right now. Please just use that email and just send a quick note of, hey, I'd love to help. I'd love to talk to my legislators. Just a quick note, and then we'll follow up with you as we need it. But it is so essential that the folks in the legislature hear directly from the constituents in the district that this bill is important to them. So if you can do that, take a moment tonight and shoot us an email. And again, we're getting close to the raffle time, so please make your contributions. And with that, I'd just like to make one last little appeal. I've been working in politics since 2004, and one of the things I've worked for President Barack Obama, for Senator Kerry, I've worked for the Democratic Party of Oregon, I've worked for local candidates, national candidates, I've worked on campaigns, and I've seen amazing things happen when no one else thought that they could. And people have defied logic. And the thing that I learned that really makes the difference between a winning and losing campaign is when people's desires for change are translated into action. You know, I used to make a joke when I was talking to folks and say, you know, I can want a six pack abs as much as for all the things in the world, but unless it is, I want it enough to start doing sit-ups every day, I'm never gonna get it. And change in politics is like that. You can want all the change in the world, but unless you're willing to put your money where your mouth is, put your money where put your time into it, put a little bit of energy, be willing to do things that maybe make you a little uncomfortable, like call a legislator or write them an email, change won't happen. And so what I hope you all do is take a moment to think about what the passing of this bill would do. What would $40 to $50 million annually put into communities of color, Black, Latinx, Alaska Native, Native American, reinvesting those monies? Well, how would that change their lives, the lives of those communities? And then ask yourself, what is that worth to me? Is it worth $10 right now? Is it worth 5 minutes on a phone call to a legislator? Is it worth 25 minutes writing an email? Is it worth talking to my friends and family? Is it worth asking them? You know, and whatever that is, please give it to us. Please stand up and give it to us. Click on the link, send us an email, and be there and be ready to move forward with us. And I think with that, I'd just like to turn this back over to Jeanette to close it out for us and do the raffle and give the last thoughts of the evening.
I am ready, Jesse.
There are too many of you.
Okay, hi everyone. Thank you so much for being with us today and hanging on till the end and hanging out through our technical difficulties as we got started. It was so good to have you all on. So I am thrilled at everyone who's donated. So many of you have given money while we were on the call, and that really just helped make this engine go. When the work group formed, it was without a long-term plan about what would happen once this thing actually started moving through the Capitol. And we quickly pivoted and created a PAC, and then that PAC needed money to go. So thank you again to Groundworks and Wild, Weed Maps and Dutchie, our kind of three big sponsors, Wild, Weed Maps, and Groundworks, and then Dutchie coming in at that next level, all having really given some big checks to make it go. But you know what? Everyone who's donated $10 to $250 also made this thing go. So thank you so much. Let's announce those raffle winners. So Rachel was already called. She is our $250 donor, Rachel Wiseman Holler. And if you were thinking about giving $250, you were like toying with the idea, anybody else who gives $250 today is also going to get this big prize pack. So you're all in if you give $250 before midnight. But Rachel, you were first, you're gonna get the best one. And then I have chosen the next raffle winner randomly from everyone who gave, and that is Samantha Grace from Ashland, Oregon. So Samantha, if you are on, we've got your address. And Rachel, we've got your address. So we're able to send, and Lisa, who got the prize for being first, you will all get these wonderful prize packs. Thank you. And then before we close, with 3 minutes till eight, so I'll say one last thing, which is just to thank all of the work group members. I said the money made it go, but we didn't get to the place of having a PAC and needing to hire a lobbyist without the 80 people who came together week after week after week. We had 3 to 4 meetings some weeks. Everybody on this work group gave really a lot of blood, sweat, and tears. It's amazing how many people it took to lift this boat, but we're really proud of what we think this is going to do and how comprehensive and effective we think this legislation is. We've been making that work group pretty open for people to join. So if you want to get engaged, as Jesse has said, if you want to do anything else in relation to us, please email info@cannabisequitypac, and we will get you signed up. There's the email address in the chat. We'll get you signed up to join the work group. We'll send you the links to sign the petitions or to write the letters. We love the engagement. It's what has made this bill so strong, is having all the different voices. So thank you. Thank you for being on today. Thank you everybody who spoke.
Hooray. Goodbye. Good night. I see wonderful good nights in the chat. Good night, everybody. Thank you to everyone who donated. There are more donations coming in, actually. Joy Hudson, thank you. Just got one more. All right. Okay. Good night.